You say the church's spiritual power may not be used to promote or oppose laws and policies that have not been commanded or forbidden by God.
Right.
Right. And this is from Calvin's perspective. But does that necessarily preclude the church using something other than its spiritual? I mean, you're saying if we're thinking about the use of the word, of preaching the word, or the sacraments, mm-hmm. That the power embedded in the church in those sacraments ought not be used mm-hmm. For these purposes. That doesn't necessarily preclude the church from right. still having this sort of role,
right? Right.
From the Christian, I mean, the leaders in the Christian Reformed Church, you know, mm-hmm. recently sending in letters about immigration or something mm-hmm. like that. But how would we distinguish one from the other?
Yeah. So one of the things maybe helpful to contextualize that for Calvin, the whole reason Calvin works out this sort of these principles of the use of church power is, remember, you had the Catholic Church, which had so abused its teaching authority and its disciplinary authority and its sacramental authority that it was tyrannizing the lives of Christians. And the Pope would, you know, put the entire Holy Roman Empire under the ban, prohibit them from the Lord's Supper because of a political dispute with the Holy Roman Empire. So that leads the other reformers to say, well, the church shouldn't touch this stuff at all. And Calvin is trying to say, no, the church has to touch this stuff. It's part of what the kingdom does and what the kingdom is. But then he knows they're going to accuse him of being sort of a new kind of papist or something, of giving the church too much power again. So he's saying the church must do this, but it has to do it in a way that is clear that we are under the lordship of Christ. And that means that the church's teaching power and disciplinary power and sacramental power is always, Calvin's favorite phrase is, bound up within the word. When we are preaching or teaching or disciplining the word, then we speak with the authority of Christ himself. But when we go beyond the word, it's suddenly just a purely human thing, which doesn't mean it's wrong. It just means we can't say this is Christ's authority now, as Rome would do. So for politics, that meant Calvin thought we should teach the political principles that are taught in Scripture. We should teach the kingdom and its righteousness for every area of life. But we can't teach in a preaching way in the name of Christ precisely what the policy implications of that are going to be. That then is left up to the vocational callings of Christians. And that's within the Christian liberty then. Now, that doesn't mean that they are free to argue for whatever they want, as if there's no right or wrong. What it means is we are now free to argue with each other and try to persuade each other and work together with collective discernment and wisdom to try to determine what the policy implications should be.